and welcome to this episode of Beer to Whiskey. I'm Russ Heaps, and today my never-ending mission to spread the gospel of good taste has brought me to Coram, Montana. And I'm here at Glacier Distillery, which is on Highway 2, just on the way to West Glacier.
Right.
And so we're going to sample a little Montana bourbon today. Here to my left, I've got my buddy of 50 years, Wrangler Rick Fowler, who is my whiskey-sipping co-conspirator on this mission. And across from me here, we've got Nic Lee, who is the owner and master distiller here. So we're going to find out a little bit about the distillery. We're going to sample a little bourbon, and life is good in Montana. Nic, tell me a little bit, how did you get this started? How did you get this distillery moving?
Yeah, we started in 2010, and kind of inspired, came out to Montana to float the rivers and fish, and along the Middle Fork of the Flathead is an old homestead, which was the Duty homestead. And Josephine Duty was a notorious moonshiner back in the early 1900s. She was originally from Georgia, a lady of ill repute, let's say, in the area here at the time. But Dan Duty, who became the first park ranger, took a fancy to her. They moved her up to his homestead, which is now in the park, so it's on the other side of the Flathead River. In any case, she was making moonshine based off of an old Georgian recipe, I'm sure, using local ingredients here, rye and corn. And we float by her homestead all the time. And so it's like, I grew up in North Carolina, studied chemistry, kind of knew how to put a few things together. So started tinkering with the idea of making moonshine in honor of her, kind of recreating what she was doing. So we set up the distillery really to recreate that legendary moonshine and started putting some in barrels and took off from there.
So obviously you've branched out far beyond moonshine, right?
Yes.
I know we've got a bourbon sitting in front of us. I know I sampled a rye that you make last mm-hmm. evening. And so what all are you concocting here?
Yeah, so we do mostly whiskeys. We're the whiskey barn, and the North Fork, the rye whiskey that you tasted, was an aged version of her old shine recipe, which was a rye-based shine. So it's been aged 2 years in new charred oak barrels, kind of done in more of a bourbon tradition. We've got the fireweed, which is in front of us. It's a bourbon whiskey blended with cherry brandy liqueur, and the cherries are all from Flathead Lake. We've got a little microclimate there and get some nice cherries in the summer. We distill and ferment and distill those, make a brandy and blend that into the bourbon to give this fireweed. And then whenever we come across local fruit, other grains, we'll tinker. We do some projects with Great Northern Brewery based off of some of their beer mashes to do whiskeys. Kind of inspired by more traditional beer recipes instead of kind of mash recipes. So
the rye is actually really a variation of moonshine. It's sort of a moonshine bourbon fusion kind of thing almost.
Yeah, so it's the recipe. So a moonshiner would make whatever they could out of the local cheap ingredient. And rye at that time grew like a weed here. So that was in her ingredient. Because she was from Georgia, was used to the little sweet finish that corn gives. So our rye recipe is about 80% rye and 20% corn. And if you distill the moonshine just off the still, any whiskey comes off clear, and it doesn't pick up that color until it gets into the barrel.
Right.
If you're a moonshiner like Josephine was, you're not storing large quantities for any period of time. You're putting it in jars and off on the railway. Since we did get a license, we had the luxury. We do have a license. we had the luxury of putting some in barrels. So we followed the kind of the bourbon tradition of aging in new charred white oak barrels to give that kind of more familiar American whiskey finish to the rye spirit.
You briefly mentioned the fact that you've got a chemistry background. You've actually got your degree, your college degree's in chemistry, is that right?
That's right, yeah. Never thought I'd put it to any practical use.
Right, and this is the first...
This is as good as any, yeah.
This is the first opportunity you've had, right?
That's right, yeah.
So, were you distilling at home? before?
I can neither confirm nor deny that. According to federal rule, even distilling for personal consumption is illegal in the U.S. Did homebrew and was familiar with the concepts of distillation, be it for water or essential oils or other. When we set up here, we really had to just learn trial by fire. Jack and Jim weren't really very open to revealing their secrets to us.
Right.
But we got a lot of inspiration actually then from looking to old school, to Europe. And the tradition of small scale distilling is much continued there, much stronger than it was here in the US after Prohibition. So we were able to find equipment and read old texts and really look back to history to re-educate ourselves on how to distill traditional spirits. So our whiskeys, obviously, with a lot of bourbon inspiration, but the malts that we do based off of the beer recipes, looking to the Scotch traditions. And we do a lot of fruit products, so a lot of schnapps and French and Swiss and Southern German traditions on those products.
I just wanted to mention, we've kind of taken a corner of the tasting room here, so there is some activity going on. If you hear some voices, that's kind of what's going on. These guys are open for business, as you are?
Year-round. In the summer is our big time. We're right next to Glacier Park, so from noon to 8, we are open here in the summer, serving up as much as we can. And then in the winter, we slow down a little bit. We do most of our production in the winter, but we've got 4 days a week where we're open here. In case someone gets tired of skiing on Big Mountain, they can come down and see what it's like out in the canyon.
If they need a little whiskey break, and who doesn't?
Exactly.
Who does? And I tell you what, if you ever visit Glacier National Park in the summer, after creeping around up there trying to get from one place to another for 4 hours and coming back down, you're going to want a little something right here. How much production do you do a year?
We're micro. I guess technically nano. We do a couple thousand cases, sell a couple thousand cases a year here. We're putting away a little bit more than that, bringing our barrel program into kind of full maturity. So we're distilling more, and you know, actually, it's always hard to tap open a barrel because you really don't want to sell it. You want it to sit there and get
better. It's your baby.
It's your baby. But we need to sell a little bit, sell just enough to fill another barrel the next season. So.
Yeah. I think you said when we visited the other day that you're extending your aging process. Is that correct?
Yeah, we kind of, the smart distillery would start with clear spirits, vodka or gin that you don't need to age, and then you'd make some money, and then you'd put some whiskey away. But we weren't that smart. We started with making whiskey, so we sold the unaged whiskey, which was the moonshine, and then we released younger whiskeys along the way just to fund the process. And now we're kind of trying to just grow the average age of our stock. So the North Fork is aged a minimum of 2 years, and the Bad Rock a minimum of 3 years. And then we'll just keep rolling that age as we go.
You know, we can see barrels behind us. Is this all your production, or do you have a rick house somewhere where you're?
In an undisclosed location.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
So we keep a lot of current inventory here. Part of the building there is actually dug into the hillside back there, so it acts kind of as a root cellar. So we have a nice environment to age barrels, a section of barrels there, and then, space is always an issue here. We're always trying to find another place to put another barrel. So,
were you a big bourbon drinker or a big whiskey drinker before you started this place?
I grew up in North Carolina. And I didn't know that there was anything else. Tennessee whiskeys and bourbons, those were always high on my list. I always tended toward that. I don't really have much of a sweet tooth. It was always more into the savory, and the whiskeys always fit the bill there, that kind of real intense flavor and the savory woody finish of those bourbons.
So what did you start out with?
As far as drinking?
As far as your bourbon.
Well, I started out at the bottom of the barrel. Whatever I could afford. I think, moved on to Jack and Jim, and I really still appreciate a nice Jim Beam. It's, those guys, the big distilleries, and maybe a little bit unlike craft breweries, that there was good quality bourbons and whiskeys being made here and in Scotland. And we weren't necessarily trying to improve on those, but we were trying to just take them and do a little twist. And love the Maker's Mark and the Woodford Reserves and those smaller batch ones. And then when we were doing our fireweed, so we do a bourbon here, but we don't just do a bourbon because those guys do a great job down there. But what we wanted to do is add a twist to it, which is why our bourbon is infused and blended with a cherry brandy. So it gives us our Montana flair to that product. And that's kind of what we do with all of our spirits is take that old traditional quality and add something or make it our own.
Well, and the flathead cherries are a great compliment to the whiskey. You know, I live down on Flathead Lake, and in the summertime, it's exploded with cherry stands and high-quality product. And it's neat that you can source a lot of your materials, if not all, here in Montana.
Yeah,
maybe you could plant a few cherry trees in your in your back 40. And you could be a cherry supplier.
There you go.
Dedicate those. We'll do a little trading.
Quid pro quo. A little trade out going on. I think that's a fine idea. So is there something, Nick, that you haven't distilled that you would like to or you're thinking about? Or?
So we've done a range of whiskeys. We've done an apple brandy, cherry brandy. We've done a Slivovitz, a Kirschwasser.
Which I have no idea what that is.
Exactly, like we've but these all are fruits. The one category we haven't gone into is the other spirits that I really enjoy are tequilas. Obviously, we can't make a tequila here in the U.S., but maybe an agave spirit or something in that direction might be fun to play with.
Sure.
But again, unless we can find someone growing it here, it's probably going to be a little bit down the road.
Yeah.
So
we
try to focus on what we do here.
Okay, so let's go into a little more depth on what we're drinking here. What exactly should we be tasting, do you think?
Right here, the idea is, the whiskeys have a strong barrel note and a big lean toward the savory. And the Flathead Lake cherries, these are dark sweet cherries, and we ferment them and we barrel age them in old wine barrels to bring out that kind of deep, sweet, rich flavor of the cherries. And we think that kind of that sweetness and that kind of bright, brighter fruit notes to it complement that bourbon really well. Classic cocktails often, the Manhattans are cherry and bourbon.
Right.
And so here what we're doing is in the nose, you want to get a little bit of that cherry. And on the first sip of it, you're going to get that sweetness of the cherry. And then as it fades, it's still an 80-proof spirit. It's not a really sweet flavored whiskey per se. It's actually a blend of a distilled cherry brandy. What you're left with is the savory, clean finish of that spirit and the nice bourbon finish at the end. So that's what we were going for.
I think you hit the mark.
Yeah, I do too. You're exactly right. The cherry's up front and the bourbon and the finish. Yeah, it's nice.
It's a great product. We use it in the summer a lot to make our version of the Lynchburg lemonade. It's the Flathead cherry lemonade. We do it with a little rosemary lemonade. Makes a perfect summer cocktail. Nice pink lemonade out of this. And then it really in the hands of a good bartender or mixologist makes a fun product because it's already got so much going to it. You just need a little bit of brightness and freshness to make a beautiful cocktail.
If I'm going to buy one of your products, I've got to buy it here, or can I
pretty much
get it outside?
In Montana, you can get it, the fireweed at least. So we have five of the products that we do here that we distribute in Montana. Otherwise, you got to come to the whiskey barn. Our single barrel rye whiskey, for example, only available here. The Kirsch and the Slivo, which I mentioned earlier, which are a cherry and a plum brandy. We just have such small volumes that really we can only afford to have them here.
Right.
Do you do events to promote the distillery? I remember talking to a lady from Whitefish and said, she and a group either came over for something and, tried different cocktails and had a really nice experience and were, said this stuff is really, really good and it makes nice cocktails. And they had a good time.
Good. So. Yeah, we do. We have ambassadors out in the field. We do. So we're quite limited with what we can do for sampling outside of the premise because it's a hard distilled spirit. But where we can, we participate in farmers markets or do events at bars where we try to feature our products And really, the to get someone to be able to connect with the product and where it's from, the biggest connection we get when people visit is the experience they had here and the flavors they tasted here when they take that bottle home with them. It, that sense, the smell and taste is such a strong memory that it can just, pull you back to a time and a place like nothing else. So, anytime we can, we want to pour people a taste so they can experience it. Because everyone's got a different palate. You got to find what you like.
Right. I think I need to come back in the summer for some Lynchburg lemonade.
That does sound tempting.
Corn lemonade here, so yeah. Fireweed lemonade.
That sounds pretty tasty. Yeah.
Well, Nick, I appreciate the invite. Thanks for hosting us and
Absolutely. Telling
us about what you're doing here. This is actually quite good, as was the rye that we tried last evening. So. It's been fun. It's been informative. It was great meeting you. And with that,
cheers.
Keep up the good work.
See you next time.